All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here with me today. My name is Nikki, and I am presenting all about Molly of Denali, and in particular, ways that we bring Molly into the classroom and use Molly as a way to celebrate different cultures in the classroom. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with a little bit more introduction so you can hear a little bit more about me. But first, I just wanted to start with a land acknowledgement. I am currently residing on the land of the Massachusetts people in Malden, Massachusetts. And I just want to honor their past, present, and future stewardship of the land and animals of this place. If you would like to see what indigenous land you are residing upon, you can go to nativeland.ca, and you can look it up there. That's where I got this image of all the different territories of North America. All right, so who am I? My name is Nikki. I am from GBH in Boston. We produce tons of different shows for PBS and PBS Kids, including Molly of Denali. I work in the education department, and I am the marketing manager for our children's brands, which is why I'm talking with you all here today. So just a brief overview of what we're going to be talking about. I'm going to start with just a series overview for those who may not be familiar with Molly, and then dig into the curriculum behind the series and how that plays out in the different stories that you see when you watch an episode of Molly. And then I'm going to talk a little bit more Alaskan Native culture and values, which are really fundamental components of the series. And then we'll dig in specifically to the PBS Learning Media Collection and specific resources for the classroom. And then I'd love to open it up to questions, which people are at any point welcome to put in the chat, or at that point we can come off mute. You can ask me as well. All right, so let's learn a little bit more about Molly. So Molly of Denali is a series that follows the adventures of curious and resourceful 10-year-old Molly Mabray. She's an Alaska Native girl who lives in the fictional village of Kaya, Alaska. Molly will visit real places in Alaska, but her actual village is not real, but it is right by Denali. Molly of Denali is really special, and it breaks new grounds on several fronts. First, it's the first nationally distributed kids series to feature a Native American lead character, which is really exciting. It's the first TV series with an integrated production module that includes Alaska Natives in all aspects of production. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more later on. It is the first series that has an informational text curriculum, which we'll also be diving into a little bit later. And this is just a fun one, but we're the first PBS kids series to have a podcast. We now have three seasons of that podcast out now for you to go listen to, which is great. So just to give you a taste of what Molly is all about, I'm going to share this little clip, which is our welcome intro to Molly of Denali.
Hey everyone, it's me, Molly!
Molly of Denali.
Let's go!
She's Molly of Denali.
By plane, a sled, or snowshoe, she is ready to explore. From Cactova down to Juneau, always wanting to learn more. Together with her best friend, to be always by her side.
And training.
Discovering the outdoors on adventures day and night.
Come along with Molly.
Molly.
Who feels a fire with.
Come along with Molly.
Molly.
From tundra to the sea.
Must see Joe. Let's go.
Molly of Denali.
So that gives you a little taste of what this series is all about. So the series centers around Molly, and this is Molly. Molly works in the Denali Trading Post, or that's where she lives with her parents, which is kind of the town center where a lot of people come to get their supplies in their village of Kaya, Alaska. Molly, and this is her here with her dog Suki, loves to go on adventures throughout Alaska. She loves hanging out with friends, going to explore the beautiful natural habitat around her, and she's always down for a fun adventure. Sometimes gets into a little bit of a mess, as you can see in one of these images, but usually ends up finding her way out of it using her informational text skills. Each episode centers around Molly having her own vlog, which is a video blog. So this series usually starts with her introducing, you know, the problem or the thing that she's going to be doing that day, which she shares out with her viewers, just to share about more about what life in Alaska is really all about. And then her best friend is Tui. Tui is family. They race dogs and they're big dog sledders. Mushers, that's Tui's dream, is to grow up to be a musher. And Tui and Molly often go on tons of adventures together, usually dog related. And Molly's other best friend is Trini. Trini is new to Alaska. She has just moved from Austin, Texas. So Molly and Tui kind of help show her around Alaska and get her acclimated to what life up further north is really like. Trini loves gardening and is renowned for growing very large cabbages, which is a fun fact about Trini. And then Molly's community is really featured very heavily in this series. You'll see her parents here on the right. Her mom, Layla, is a bush pilot, often flies and supplies to their remote village. And Molly's dad, Walter, is a wilderness guide. So he's often taking people out on treks to explore Alaska. To the left, you see her Auntie Midge. She is the tribal elder of the village and has a ton of just wisdom that she often shares with Molly and other characters from the series. And then we have other people. Mr. Patuk is a woodworker. Nina is a scientist and is often going on science adventures that she brings Molly along with. And then we see Grandpa Nat here on his snowmobile. Grandpa Nat is Molly's grandfather, and he is a volcanologist and studies volcanoes. So just you get a sense of some of the characters that are in the series. And then we always say another character is really the Alaskan landscape. We're so honored to get to show this beautiful place in the series. And our hope is really to show an authentic portrayal of what life in Alaska is really like. Often in the media, you'll see very sensationalized, like reality shows that kind of hype up the dangers of living in Alaska. But we really wanted to show what it's really like to live here as people do and celebrate all the beauty that Alaska has to offer. All right, so that's a basic overview of the series, and now we'll dig in a little bit more into the stories and curriculum. So the main curriculum focus for Molly of Denali is informational text, and I just wanted to share our definition of it, just so we're all on the same page, although I'm sure some of you are already familiar with this. But we say informational text is defined as text whose primary purpose is to convey information, which this can be in print, oral, audio, visual, and digital forms. It can be as short as a tweet or as lengthy as an encyclopedia. And then just to ground you a little bit deeper in some kinds of text that you often see in the series is we have informative or explanatory text, which is to convey information about the natural or social world, procedural or how-to text, so steps listed out to teach something, how to do something, biographical, to interpret and share the experiences of a person. We have nonfiction narrative in the series, which shares the story of a real-life event, and then functional text to support carrying out everyday tasks like maps and charts and things like that. So Molly and her friends use all these different kinds of text in every episode of the series, which you see when you're watching Molly, often to help them learn more about the world around them or to solve a problem that they're having. And it comes up in a bunch of different fun ways. So here's just some examples of what that actually looks like coming up through the series. First, starting with these two images on the left, Molly is trying to help Grandpa Nat find hot springs that he remembers finding out in the wilderness. And the last thing he remembers is a tree shaped in this shape. So he draws it, and Molly goes on a search to use that piece of text to try to find directions to where the hot spring is, which you see her doing underneath the stars there. In the middle set of stories, Molly is really excited about catching her first fish, which is a big tradition for her. You get your first fish story when you catch your first fish, but she's having trouble catching a salmon. So she uses her knowledge of the salmon life cycle and draws out a chart of it to try to figure out where would the best place be to catch this salmon fish. And then over here on the right, Molly, Trini, and Tui are competing in a canoe race, and they want to learn how they can be better. So they go to the library and look up resources to help them figure out the best techniques and things for racing canoes. So it comes up in a lot of different ways, but every single episode has informational text being used at some point in the story. So here is a clip that can show you a little bit of what this actually looks like in this series. And I just want to say too that informational text is definitely the cornerstone of our curriculum, but so is Alaska Native culture and values. And you'll see how those two things are kind of woven together in this story here.
You okay there, Molly?
I got it. I don't got it. Sorry, Daniel. Huh?
People of the rivers?
Yeah, that's an old book about the tribes who live along the rivers.
Ooh, what's going on in this picture?
Why don't you read the caption? Captions give more information about pictures and photos.
The caption says, "Mushers play an important role in transporting goods through the community." Pictured here, Tim Hawk, musher, age 46. Who feeds their dogs in dance regalia?
It's like farming in your fancy clothes.
She's wearing regalia to clean fish?
Who wants fish slime on moose hide?
Maybe the caption will tell us. Fish are an important staple of the Alaskan diet. Families go to fish camps each summer. Pictured here, Sarah Johnson, age 25.
Nothing about why she's dressed up or looks so grumpy. Everyone I know is happy at fish camp.
Well, no one's happy in here.
How can you call your book People of the Rivers if it doesn't look anything like the people of the rivers?
It isn't very accurate, but Auntie Midge is in here somewhere.
What? Where?
There she is.
Wow. Who's that with her?
It doesn't say. Where's the caption when you need one?
I know who can tell us who the mystery man is.
Oh, that's my Uncle Isaac. This is what he really looked like.
Ah, he seems fun.
He was. That picture in the book doesn't look anything like him. No one in there looks like themselves. The photographer told us not to smile.
That's why everyone looks so grumpy.
And he made us wear regalia for everything.
Huh. Someone should fix this book.
Mm-hmm. I told him he should take pictures of one of our funny face competitions and put those in there, but he wouldn't.
Huh? Funny face competition?
So I'm sure you can see where that episode is going. And yes, they do hold a funny face competition. But as evidenced in that clip, when we teach kids about informational text, it's not just about how to use informational text, right, to find information, but it also is about challenging the informational text that you find and thinking critically about the informational text that you have in front of you and how to check it with multiple sources. And then also about creating your own informational text. So where this story ends up leading is Molly and Tui end up creating their own book about their community with their own captions, with their own photos, but of the funny face competition representing what people are actually like in their community instead of that book. So that was a basic overview of the curriculum, but now I really want to dig in for the bulk of today's presentation on the culture and representation as evidenced in the series. And just to give you all a little bit of background of why this is so important. Traditionally, Alaska Native and Native American people are relatively invisible in the media. I think they make up less than 1% of children's cartoon characters, which is problematic, of course, for people. We know representation is really important for young people to see people who look like them in the shows and TV that they're watching. But not only has it been so small, the number of people who've been represented of Native American descent, but oftentimes they've been portrayed inaccurately and negatively. There's a lot of examples of things like stuck and frozen in time, the silent representations, someone who doesn't even speak who's Native, a native princess who often doesn't speak and is helpless or needs to be rescued. Other caricatures, as I'm sure you've witnessed or can see here from the images, of just how Native Americans are represented. And there have been studies that show that that exposure to young people of Native American descent to these images, these negative portrayals, can actually cause them to feel more negatively about themselves, their community, and in additional, their academic possibilities. So it's really problematic. And that is something that the series Molly of Denali really set out to counter. The hope is that we can represent Alaska Native culture and communities authentically and celebrate the beauty that is found within these cultures. As you can see here in some of Molly's images and stories, oftentimes it's also about showing culture in a modern context, right? That these communities are not frozen in time, they're modern peoples living in modern ages that still celebrate their traditions, just as anybody else still celebrates their heritage and their family traditions. So you can see throughout the stories represented here, we have people rowing in a traditional boat to celebration in Alaska. Molly visits a friend in Atka and learns a traditional dance. You'll see her in dance regalia in the bottom left. In the middle, Molly is competing in the Native Youth Olympics, which are a series of traditional games that Native people use to practice skills for hunting and things, and are now celebrated in Native Youth Olympic competitions. And she's competing on the slippery barrel crawl, I guess you would say. We see Molly at a totem raising and learning about totems and their history and the stories that they represent. Again, Molly and Tui dancing together in their regalia, their celebration outfits. In the bottom right, Molly and her family going to fish camp, which is a traditional thing a lot of Alaska Native families do together in the summer to collect their salmon for the year together. So it's about showing the beautiful like culture and history and traditions, but also showing them in this modern context and celebrating that within Molly's community. So I have a clip here, and this is from one of our, I would say, most pivotal stories, one of our most groundbreaking. It's the first story that came out from Molly of Denali. It's called Grandpa's Drum. This clip is actually a series of smaller clips strung together to kind of tell you the whole story, but it's particularly relevant now because it deals with the forced boarding schools many Native kids had to be sent to. Which is coming up again a lot in the news recently. So this story kind of tackles with how do you tell kids and teach kids about that history in an age-appropriate way. So you'll see that here in this clip.
Okay, let's see what you got.
It's a picture of you. At least I think it's you. You're singing with a little girl.
Oh, that's me, all right. From a long time ago.
How come I've never heard you sing? You should sing with us at the show tonight!
Sorry, Segoya. I don't sing anymore.
But how can you not sing? Everybody sing!
Ho-ho! I don't sing anymore because I don't have my drum. I gave it away and poof! All the songs I knew went with it. I cannot sing a note.
Where is it? Your drum?
I left it with her. I wonder if she kept it.
Aw, look how cute Dad was. The girl I don't know. She's probably someone Grandpa met when he was sent away to school.
Sent away?
Yes, back then people like us, Native kids, were sent off to boarding school. Had to leave their family, their friends, their homes. It was a hard time for Grandpa. That's why you never hear him talk about it. It makes him too sad.
Hey, there you are. You ready to sing?
Ready. And maybe you will be too, because...
Oh, Molly.
Tui and I found your friend in the picture and brought back your drum. Do you have your songs again?
I left them so far behind, they'll need to find their way back to me.
That's okay, Chada. I'm just glad we could find it for you.
Molly, we're next!
stand. Hey, who, hey, 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 hey.
Hallelujah.
So as you can see in that clip, it deals with Alaska Native culture and also the history of Alaska Native people and what they went through in their region and things that are specific to them. But it shares it in a way that is digestible for kids of all ages and I think relatable to kids regardless of your background. So in addition to showing like Alaska Native history and culture and stories, we also use a lot of Alaska Native values that are woven into every single episode of Molly of Denali. And I want to say that these values are commonly shared among a lot of different Alaska Native tribes, but they are by no means finite list. There are many more values that are also shared in common among these groups of people, but these are some of the ones that we use in the series frequently. And when we create new episodes of the series, we'll obviously have our curriculum tie-in. So what parts of the curriculum will we have it woven into the story? And we'll also usually have our Alaska Native value tie-in. So which one of these values will we highlight or share as part of the story that is written? So some of them are showing respect to others, acknowledging that each person has a special gift that should be respected, sharing what you have because giving makes you richer, knowing who you are because you are an extension and a part of your family, accepting what life brings because you cannot control many things or everything, having patience because some things cannot be rushed, living carefully because your actions have consequences, taking care of others because you cannot live without them, honoring your elders because they show you the way in life, and seeing connections that all things are related. And I'll talk a little bit more about who is part of the team, but it's why having Alaska Native peoples represented in all facets of creating the series is so important. Because for example, one of our writers who is not Alaska Native wrote a story. And in it, Molly was having a cup of tea and visiting the local woodworker, Mr. Patuck. And she needed a piece of information from him. So she rushed in, asked him the questions, and then rushes out and leave. And as that story was going through review, an Alaska Native advisor said, you know, an Alaska Native kid never would have rushed in, got information, and just rushed out. That's not how it would be. They would come in, sit, show respect to that elder by being patient and having spending some time with them, getting the knowledge, thanking them for that knowledge, and then leaving. So that's just why it's so important to not just know these values, but also have people who are in the communities you're represented be a part of your team, because they're just things you won't know if you won't know, right? And so that ties me into this point, nothing about us without us. So one of the goals for this program was to certainly create better representation on screen for Alaska Native people, but equally as important as having better representation behind the scenes as well. So we've really strived to have Alaska Native representation in all sorts of different elements of the production. So our production team, we have a creative producer and other members, production coordinators and assistants who are Alaska Native themselves, which is really important. We have our Alaska Native Working Group, which is a series of people who help us come up with stories and who train other members of the team to know more about Alaska Native culture and values. For Molly of Denali, we did a screenwriters fellowship, which was specifically looking to engage Alaska Native writers and have them be a part of this fellowship and give them support so they could write stories for our series. Apologies, my dog is barking right now. We also made sure to voice cast in Alaska and the Northwest to make sure that we have people who are of Alaska Native or First Nations or Native American descent be our voice cast for this series. And we also have many, many cultural advisors, which is really important for creating a show that is authentic to the communities that we're trying to represent. And you'll see here in these images, this is Sydney. She's a member of our production team drawing the totems that you then see in a Tale of the Two Totems episode with Molly later. And again, it is just so important to make sure we have people who are of Alaska Native descent representing these Alaska Native communities. Just to like drive this point home even further, we have many language advisors as well for this series. And as you can see in this graphic, I think there are more than 20 different Alaska Native languages spoken in Alaska. And we have 5 different advisors just for language, although I'm sure we could have more. And you will hear words, different words, Alaska Native languages in the series, but it's just, again, trying to make sure that we are representing, because let's just say we had just one language advisor. As you can see, there's no way that language advisor is going to know all these different languages of all these different regions. So it's important to make sure we have that different kinds of representation. So that's an overview of culture and of Alaska Native culture and values. But now I really wanted to spend the bulk of the time kind of digging into the classroom resources we have for Molly of Denali and focusing on how we can use these resources to not only learn about Molly's community and culture, but to also then celebrate the different cultures and communities that you might have represented in your classroom. So PBS Learning Media, for those of you who don't know, is a website that has all of the different educational resources for a whole bunch of different PBS series. And it's not just children's series, it's also adult series. It has just all the resources you could ever imagine for any topic you could ever imagine. And often what it does is it will take clips from either a documentary or a series and provide educational context and support for using that clip in the classroom. So here is our Molly of Denali collection. So on PBS Learning Media, our collection has 10 different lesson plans that you can use, 4 interactives. In Molly's case, those are, we have a lot of web games. So they're educational supports for using those web games in the classroom, if that's of interest. 15 different video resources and clips with context for why you might use that clip in the classroom. 4 handout like PDF activities, one of which I'm definitely going to dive into later. And even more handouts, more background readings and different sorts of resources. As I said earlier, Molly's main curriculum focus is informational text, but also a big focus is Alaska Native culture and values. So often you'll see some resources are going to be targeted more towards the informational text, but others might be targeted more towards the cultural piece. And some are both and might be woven into both of those. And then I just wanted to quickly dive into anatomy of a resource, just so you know what you're going to find. So if I go back one, so if you click on the first lesson plan right there, the worm turns, it'll open up a page that looks like this. And I just wanted to dive into what all this means, because if it's new to you, it can be a little confusing. So obviously at the top, you'll have the name and the collection that it's a part of, what grades it's suitable for, and what kind of resource this is in right under the title. Then if you start, let's start from the left and work our way over. Starting all the way on the left is our integration to Google Classroom, if that's of interest. So you can always assign or share straight to Google Classroom if you're logged in. Then you'll see the lesson overview. The lesson overview will give you basically your lesson summary, how long the lesson will take, what the learning objectives are, any prep you might need to do to get the lesson ready for your classroom. It'll go through the specific learning goals that this lesson plan addresses. For Molly, we actually have 15 different learning goals, which is a lot of different learning goals. They're all related to informational text. So if you're trying to hit, let's say, a specific one of those learning goals, it'll tell you right here which one of those that you'll hit. And it will also let you know what supplies you might need for doing this lesson in your classroom. Then next to overview, if you click on procedure, it'll open up a different page, which will be the actual lesson instructions. So it'll walk you through, here's how you run this lesson in your classroom. Sometimes they'll have different teaching prompts, like here's some language you can use or questions you can ask your classroom. And it will also go through the specific activity, letting you know how to run that activity in your classroom with your students. Sometimes there's different activity options and you can kind of take them whichever way is best suited for your classroom. Then next to the procedure, you'll see standards. And if you do click on that in the resource, it'll let you know the national standards that this lesson plan aligns to. If you're signed into PBS Learning Media like I am, it will also give you your state standards that the lesson aligns to, which I know can be really, really helpful for educators looking to hit on certain standards. Or if you just are like, well, what does this even touch on? All that information is right there for you to let you know. And then moving on to the right-hand side of this page is where you'll find the support resources for the lesson or the resource. So it starts with the media in this lesson. This lesson is accompanied by a clip from Molly of Denali. So you would click on that and it will take you right to the video clip to use in the classroom. Underneath the media in this lesson, you'll see support materials for teachers. That is where we put, whether that be background reading, teaching tips, other things, whatever you would need to know to run this lesson effectively, that's where all those live for this lesson plan. It's an article talking about why informational text is important for young learners and what that looks like, and also how to use and create informational text at home, which could be a support you either give to parents or might be good for you to know as well. And then underneath support materials for teachers, there'll be the support materials to use with students. So these are usually handouts for students, readings your students you might want to give your students for them to do. And sometimes there are actual like handouts and activity sheets, which you'll find right here. And I didn't say this earlier, but I should just say all of this stuff on PBS Learning Media is free, free to use, free to download. Signing in for an account is free. Just FYI, all of this is here for you to use. We want you to use it. Please use it. So in this resource, you'll see that background readings are on Alaska Native culture. So that's introducing your students to what is Alaska Native culture. And there's an article celebrating cultures with Molly of Denali, which was written by one of our advisors talking about ways to use Molly at home with families to celebrate cultures. And then the handouts are the 15 learning goals and some kinds of informational text for your students just to have like quick, I don't want to call them cheat sheets, but fast information sheets that has all that information listed there. So that's the anatomy of a resource, but now I want to dive specifically into a couple ones that I think are really stellar as part of the Molly collection, touching on culture. So I showed you all the clip of Grandpa's drum earlier. That was from the series. That in and of itself is a resource on PBS Learning Media. To help your students think about Alaska Native culture or learn more about Alaska Native culture. But also we have an accompanying resource called The Making of Grandpa's Drum, which is a more of a behind the scenes video clip that looks into why and how that story was made. And I'll play that for you in a second so you can hear more. But essentially, one of our tribal elders, Luke Titus, shared his story about going to boarding schools, and that is what inspired the story of Grandpa's Drum. But you can share that with your students. And then here's two pictures of some of those accompanying handouts I was talking about. So I think I touched on the Alaska Native culture handout a second ago, but it's a handout that dives into common myths or stereotypes about Alaska Native culture. It introduces like realities behind Alaska Native culture. What are some of the things that are common among Alaska Native peoples? And also gives further resources if people want to dive a little bit deeper. And then another resource that accompanies this asset or this video is a Grandpa's Drum Family Viewing Guide. And what this resource has is it has an introduction to both Grandpa's Drum and this video clip, The Making of Grandpa's Drum. It provides more context and more background reading, and it also gives suggested discussion questions and ways to talk about these issues and these episodes with students or young people. It says a family viewing guide, but I think it also can be used in an educational context as well with teachers, and again, provides additional resources for people who want to learn more or who want to just delve into this history a little bit deeper. So now I'm going to play this video so you can see the making of Grandpa's Drum.
The Grandpa's Drum episode has taught me more about Native traditions. Boarding schools were a part of many people's lives. It's this big topic that not a lot of people know about.
Who are they?
Grandpa's Drum holds this big weight that is in many Native communities.
Grandpa Nat?
Ooh, that's me, all right. From a long time ago.
We had a tribal elder, Luke Titus, who shared this very personal, very emotional story from his own life. As a young child being asked to disassociate himself from his heritage.
The experience that we had in boarding school was quite a cultural shock to us. I did not understand why people were so angry at us for talking our language or singing our native song.
If I can't sing our songs, I just won't sing anymore. Ever.
A lot of kids did the same. That's why so many of us stopped using our language and singing our songs.
So the challenge becomes, how can you tell that story in a way that a small child would understand it?
It'd be horrible not to sing anymore. Too bad he can't get his drum back.
That's it!
Whoa!
What's it?
We'll get Grandpa's drum back!
What?
If he has his drum back, his songs might come back too.
Molly, look!
Molly goes on this mission and helps her grandpa.
Yes! Woo!
Maybe if you give your grandpa back his drum, his songs will come back too.
Yay!
Molly just brings this lovingness and support to her grandpa.
Molly.
Teaching us all about this hard topic. When he's singing, he's crying because it's really emotional to get your songs back.
Grandpa's songs came back to him. And now he's teaching all his songs to us.
We're definitely aiming with every story to really hit on those Alaska Native values. The more we're able to share, the richer we are.
Those of us that lived through that, it was quite a journey for us to come back and be able to live that story. I'm able to keep singing, I'm able to keep drumming, I'm able to keep telling stories about my people.
So that's one resource you can share with your students or with your families. And then something else I like to do, as Princess mentioned in that video, is sharing Alaska Native values is really important as well. And we have this as a resource that accompanies that video. It's a handout for your students on Alaska Native values, which I went over earlier, but something that I heard suggested or that you could do in the classroom is, I know a lot of classrooms have community standards or our community guidelines or things like that that sometimes classrooms collaborate around. I think this could be a great way to begin that conversation in the classroom or discuss it with your students. You know, here are some Alaska Native values. Do we feel like we have these values, or are these similar to some of our values at home? Are any of these familiar? What ones can we add? I think it's a great way to start that discussion of Alaska Native values, and then also bring that into your classroom and to hear from your students about what are their community values or their family values, or do any of these feel familiar to them? I even know some classrooms have made a big poster out of this and hung them up, including additions that they've added, that they've come up with together. So it's a great way, again, to celebrate Alaska Native values, but then also hear from your students and hear what their values are, or create a collective group set of values in your own classroom. Another resource that I wanted to talk about, because I think it's great both for discussing Alaska Native culture and values, but also your own students, is Brand New Flag. So this resource in PDBS Learning Media is a video clip. And the story, just to give you some background, is Molly does a school report on Benny Benson, who was a young Alaska Native boy who actually won the contest to design the Alaska state flag when he was little, when he was young. And it is the state flag of Alaska today, which is really, really cool and exciting for Molly when she finds that out. And so in the episode, she decides that she wants to come up with her own flag for the Denali Trading Post. And she holds her own contest to have people submit their own flag drawings. So you learn about, in this lesson, you learn about that history, you learn about that story, and you learn about Molly's experience at the Denali Trading Post. But then after you go through all of that and learn about all of that, we have this handout, which is Make Your Own Flag, which you give to your students, and it's their turn to then design a flag that represents either them or their family or their neighborhood or their community. And then also for the informational text tie-in, they also have a space to do captions that helps explain their design, right? Which is tying in that informational text piece as well to this resource. But I just think it's a great way to not only dive into this Alaska Native history and learn about the Alaska state flag and who created it, and then also learn about Molly's experience, but then have your students have their own opportunity to make something through art that kind of represents them, or again, their families or their communities. It's just like, a lovely way to celebrate your students while also learning about this whole history and values. And I love the idea again of hanging these all up around the classroom so you can see everyone's different flags and their captions explaining, you know, why they chose certain pieces that they did. Another resource that I want to dive into is Molly's recipe book activity. This is one of those, remember I said there were lesson plans, there were video resources, there were interactives, and then there were handouts. And this is one of the PDF handouts. So on PBS Learning Media, when you click it, you get a huge PDF file that you can download for free again. And what it is it's a whole booklet on recipes, and it's made by Molly and add your name here, whichever student. And it starts with going through some recipes that we've given from either from the series or other recipes that are just common recipes used in Alaska or Alaska Native recipes. And then there's space at the end for students to add their own recipes. So again, this is hitting on informational text because recipes and directions and descriptions are a form of informational text, which is great. And you're learning to read informational text, but also create your own. But it also dives into that cultural piece as well. So I have an image here. Molly makes Grandpa Nat's Nivagi, which is a type of ice cream, for lack of a better term, but it is a traditional recipe made with moose fat and berries. And mashed wild carrots, and it kind of gets an ice cream-like consistency. We have a whole episode where Molly learns how to make Grandpa Nat's secret recipe, which her dog eats, so she has to come up with her own recipe. It's a very exciting episode. But, you know, it's introducing a new kind of food that maybe kids who are not in Alaska might not have ever heard of or experienced before, right? And then learn how to make it. And it's these like traditional recipes that are passed down from generation to generation. Then here I also have an example of carrot and ginger soup with sourdough croutons. Carrots and ginger, just things that are commonly grown in Alaska. I think there's also a recipe for blueberry milk, which is another like family recipe that we sourced from Alaska. So it has these food items that your students might not be familiar with, and you can talk about those and where they come from. But then students can also have the opportunity to maybe share their own family recipes. You know, maybe they have a family member who's passed down some sort of family recipe or something that they hold of a lot of significance to them that they can also add to this cookbook. And it's a great way to even make a classroom cookbook, right? And collect all those different recipes from different kids and different cultures and have them have the opportunity to share that with their classmates as well as they all dive deeper into delicious food recipes and things like that. So that is my overview, and I wanted to save some time for questions, and I'm happy to take any right now. I can dig through the chat quickly to see if there are any questions in the chat. I'm looking right now, and yes, I'm happy to share my slides after this presentation. No issues whatsoever there. Oh, I'm so glad people enjoyed. I'll definitely send links to the presentation, and I can also send links to all the individual resources I went over, if that would be helpful as well. I can do a whole resource list. Are there similar resources for older students? So Molly of Denali in particular, the series is aimed at students. I think we say who are aged between 6 and 8, so that's early elementary. I think you can definitely go older with these resources as well. I think there's no issues at all. I think we've actually heard that people comment all the time. They're like, I don't even have children, but you know, that story on Grandpa's Drum was really meaningful. I think it resonates. I don't think there's a tight age frame, but if you have specific resources that you're looking for in mind for your age group, what's great about PBS Learning Media is you can search by content topic as well as by age range. That way you can find the resources that are specifically tailored to your individual needs. You can also search specifically by standards, which is also really helpful, I know, for some educators as well. Oh, I'm so glad people are enjoying it. I'm so glad people want to share. Yes, I can add the link to the website. It's native-land.ca. I sent that accidentally to one person. Native-land.ca is the land where you can look up what indigenous lands you are currently residing on. Yes, I hope you share. Any more questions? Let me just keep reading through. Oh, I'm so glad everybody enjoyed. I do know too, if you're looking specifically for resources on Indigenous culture for older students, we definitely have collections on PBS Learning Media who are for middle to high school students specifically on Indigenous experiences. And I know we have a whole collection on Indigenous perspectives on climate, if that's of interest as well. Great. Awesome. If there are no more questions, I'll just do my final slide, which is saying thank you in many different Indigenous languages. You might hear often in the series, Masicho, which is thank you in Gwich'in. But Anabasi is another one you would hear a lot, which is Koyukon. But as I said, there are over 20 different languages in Alaska, spoken by Alaska Native peoples, and here are just some of them.